So welcome to our webinar. I'm Cyrienne Fournier, corrosion engineer at Geostop for 6 years ago now. Our subject today is improving lifetime of underground storage, corrosion monitoring. So the plan for this presentation will be the following. First, I will briefly introduce our company, Geostop. Then I will describe the methodology to protect casings from corrosion. Thirdly, I will present corrosion monitoring, and I will finish with some examples based on feedbacks from Geostock Experian. So Geostock. Geostock is a French company specialized in underground storage. We can mainly distinguish three different types of underground storage. Mined caverns, where the caverns are excavated mechanically. Salt caverns, where the caverns are created by a leaching process, and porous storage, where a natural porous geological layer is used to store gas, so for example, CO2, natural gas, or compressed air. Concerning our jobs, we can intervene at different steps of storage life. First, we can do some preliminary studies during advice and design, location selection, pre-feasibility, basic design, or front-end engineering design, FEED. During construction phase, we can do some project management, call for tenders, training for operators, supervision, or commissioning. And last, during operation and maintenance phase, we can do operation monitoring, control and integrity monitoring, storage maintenance. For more information, this is our website address over there. Then, these three underground storage types are very different, but they have one common point, which is their casings. Casing is a vertical tube, most of the time metallic, that will help to isolate the stored fluid from its geological environment. When it is metallic and in carbon steel especially, which is what we will suppose hereafter, it will be subjected to internal and external corrosion. So we will start a poll right now at the right top of your screen, asking you, in your opinion, what does represent the cost associated to corrosion for maintenance and repair per year? Is it 0.02% of global GDP, gross domestic product, 0.2% or 2%? I let you choose, and I will give you an external, and I will give you the answer later. So, now that we know then that casing can be corroded by internal or external risks, how to protect casings from corrosion? First, we need to understand that corrosion is a natural phenomenon. So when I say natural, it means that the iron will have a natural tendency to come back to its stable chemical state, which is iron oxide. We call it rust, usually. Here, we can observe some example of internal corrosion caused by bacteria development over there, or external corrosion due to a bad contact between casings and structures. What is important to understand is that corrosion is always due to the combination of two reactions. One, oxidation that transforms the iron Fe into Fe2+, and one reduction that will reduce some oxidants in contact with the metal as oxygen or water. One reaction could not occur without the other. And of course, we need a conductive fluid which can be water or a humid air, that will help the circulation of the ions. Which means that in a perfectly dry environment, there will be no corrosion, as the ions would not be able to circulate between the cathode and the anode. So to slow down corrosion, several solutions are possible. The first is passive protection. So the passive protection consists in applying painting or coating on the metallic surface. Here you have some examples of passive protection. The first two protections act as a barrier. They will stop water and any oxidant to access the surface, and corrosion reaction will not occur. The two other, galvanizing with zinc or projected aluminium, will more act as a sacrificial layer. They are based on galvanic coupling, and zinc or aluminium will act as the anode, whereas steel will act as the cathode and will be protected. For this protection, surface preparation is the key point. The second way to protect the casings is cathodic protection. So cathodic protection is a technique based on electricity and redox potential to control corrosion of a metal. So if cathodic protection exists, it is globally thanks to these two men that I will present. So the first one is Walter Nernst. He was a German physicist, and he created Nernst equation that allows to associate a potential expressed in millivolt to a redox couple. So here I have an example of a Nernst equation for the couple Fe2 plus Fe. The second man to the right side is Marcel Pourbet. He was a Belgian electrochemist, and he created the famous diagram called Pourbet diagram. So this is an example of this diagram, where he used the equation of Nernst to create a diagram in function of potential and pH. On this diagram, we can see the domain of corrosion of the iron, which is here and here. Also, its domain of passivation over there, and its domain of stability or immunity. The principle of cathodic protection is to reduce iron potential to achieve its domain of stability. So over there, minus 0.5 to 6 millivolts. So this is what we do to protect casings that are immersed or buried. We use a rectifier over there that will behave as a battery. And anodes that will be immersed or buried, otherwise the current cannot circulate. And we will inject a current from the anode to the surface that needs to be protected, here a casing. Only surfaces where the current can enter are protected. So it means that if the anode are outside of the casing, only the external part of the casing will be protected. The internal part will not be protected. So of course, there are a lot of theoretical calculations to find the optimal current to get the best potential. But I will not describe this calculation in this presentation. The third way to protect casings is to use additives. Most famous additives are the corrosion inhibitors. You can find some inhibitors that are cathodic, so it's inhibitors at the top side. So it means that they will prevent the reaction with the oxidant. So with this type of inhibitor, the reaction with the oxidant will not happen. With the second type of corrosion inhibitor, which will more act with the anodic surface, the reaction between the iron transformed into Fe2 plus will not happen. Another type of additives that are also very helpful in storage and for the casings are, for example, the oxygen scavengers. So oxygen scavenger will consume oxygen with, for example, in this reaction, some bisulfite or sulfite. It is very useful when the oxygen is the main oxidant in the reaction of the corrosion. We can also use some biocide that will kill the bacteria. This will be necessary when we observe some corrosive bacteria in one environment. So just before moving to the next chapter, I will look at the poll and the various results. So I see that the major answer is 2%, and you were right, exactly. The cost relative to corrosion repair is 2% of the global gross domestic product, which is about $1 trillion per year. So now that we have implemented protections to fight against corrosion, how to check the effectiveness of these protections? Here comes the corrosion monitoring. The first way to check the corrosivity of the environment and its evolution over time is to analyze the fluid that is present inside the casing, but also outside the casing. So for example, we can analyze the bacteria, the sulfate or sulfur reducing bacteria that will be corrosive and we will need to check it in the soil or in the water. We can also analyze some chemical parameters as the pH of water or the soil pH, some presence of corrosive elements as H2S or chloride, and some physical parameters like suspended solids or conductivity. Here we can see an example with the water full of suspended solids, which would create some erosion with the velocity. The second way to check the effectiveness of protection is the measurement of potentials. This measurement will be realized only when cathodic protection is implemented. So when we measure the potential while the rectifier is working, what we measure is not the real potential of the casing. It is disturbed by the resistance of the soil or water. In order to eliminate this interference, we measure also the potential off, so measure off here. The instantaneous off is the casing potential measured immediately after the cathodic protection system is switched off. It allows to eliminate the ohmic resistance of the circuit. So with this principle, we can measure the potential with different meters, and after we can plot it on the next slide here and see if it is satisfactory with our threshold. So on the graph here, we can observe the potential on, the potential off, and also two thresholds that were defined for this specific case. There are two thresholds, one in the absence of the bacteria and one in case of presence of bacteria. When we observe some bacteria, we decreased the threshold with 100 millivolts to be sure to have a right protection in presence of these corrosive microorganisms. So in this case, we can see that the potential off is lower than the threshold, so the cathodic protection is satisfactory. The third method to check the effectiveness of the system implemented to protect our casing is to use corrosion coupon. So corrosion coupon is a piece of metal that was that has the same metallic composition as casein, and monitoring of its weight through time, we can deduce a corrosion speed. So here we have an example of some corrosion probes. Some of these corrosion probes were connected to cathodic protection, and we can observe white layers that protect them on the surface. And the corrosion coupons that were not connected to the cathodic protection, we can observe some rust on their surface. So we can really see with this method a difference between coupons that are connected to the cathodic protection and coupons that are not. Some companies also developed electro-resistive probes that can directly indicate a corrosion speed without any handling. The fourth method to check the state of our casein is to carry out some inspections. So it's possible to carry out some inspection in all kind of underground cavern with various tools. So here we talk specially about decennial inspection, which is a global inspection carried out every 10 years in a mined cavern. The objective of this inspection is to define the corrosion status of casings and warranty the integrity of the storage toward the administration. So various tools can be used as an ultrasonic tool, which is at the left side here, a caliper at the right side, or camera in the middle. And Geostock acquired skills and for all kinds of inspection in each type of storage. So here we have an example of a video from a camera that was passed into a casein. And we observe the joint. And we can also notice some corrosion directly at the surface of the casein. Over there, for example. The fifth and last point to monitor the effectiveness of the protection is to develop WIMS, Well Integrity Management System. The main idea of this strategy is to realize a global monitoring of the asset and the well to determine potential leaks paths, develop performance indicators or well and storage barrier schematic. So I will not enter into the details of this presentation because we did also one webinar about this subject, performance in decision-making hydrocarbon storage integrity, which is available on Geostock channel on webikeo.com or on YouTube. So I will start now our last part after the main five solutions to guarantee a good production of casings and equipment. So this last part, I will present some examples of corrosion monitoring based on Geostock experience. The first case is in mined cavern. Casing, for this case, were immersed in water and protected by anode via cathodic protection. So here we monitor the potential of the casing, and we observed a lot of variation of potential through the whole depth of the casing. We observed also some unprotected areas, between 30 meter depth and 130 meters, and a lot of very, very high peaks. After some research, we discovered that each peak of potential corresponds to one anode location. A second observation was that when we analyzed the parameters of the water that was in outside of the casing, we observed that the conductivity of this water was very low. It was too low, actually, 300 microsiemens per centimeter. Because of this too low conductivity, the current was not able to circulate in the areas between two anodes. This explains the drop of potential between two anodes that we can observe between these peaks and this peak, and also the underprotection over there. So, to remedy to this issue, we implement two solutions. The first one was the injection of calcium chloride in the water around the casing to increase its conductivity. The second solution was to replace the FeSe anodes by linear titan MMO anode. After these two corrections, the potential of casing measured in water was satisfactory and the conductivity was higher, which is also better for the cathodic protection. So here we can see the potential on and the potential off and the threshold, and we can see that the potential off is always lower than this threshold. The second feedback is about sulfidogenic bacteria. So in underground storage, it is possible to observe sulfidogenic bacteria development. It can be sulfate-reducing bacteria that are called SRB, or thiosulfate-reducing bacteria, TRB. Both live in an anaerobic environment and will produce H2S, hydrogen sulfide, by consuming sulfate or thiosulfate ions. This H2S will increase corrosion speed. So in one case, in one mined cavern, we observed an important corrosion speed, which was due to this sulfidogenic bacteria. So on the left graph, you can see the corrosion speed for non-protected coupon at the bottom and protected coupon at the front. What we observe is that the non-protected coupon had a very, very high corrosion speed, about more than 300 micrometer per year. We can also visually observe the corrosion coupon, and we see that the non-protected one was very corroded and even broken by the corrosion, whereas the coupon that was connected to the cathodic protection was looks very better. So with this corrosion speed measurement and with this visual inspection, we can deduce that the cathodic protection is effective to struggle the corrosion due to sulfidogenic bacteria. However, it's not because the cathodic protection is efficient that it's not necessary to treat. In GeoStock, we recommend to treat when SRB or TRB concentration is higher than 1,000 bacteria per milliliter. So how to select the optimal biocide? We implemented some laboratory tests adapted to each type of storage. The objective was to determine the best concentration to kill or deactivate bacteria. But we did not want to kill only planktonic bacteria that are suspended in water. We wanted also to kill the sessile bacteria that developed biofilm in the surface, in every surface of the casing or even in your underground storage cavern. The idea of this protocol was to develop bacteria in the same condition as underground storage, but in the laboratory. So this was in the reactors that you can see here, in anaerobic condition with the same temperature of your underground storage. And after, to test this development of bacteria with different biocide at different concentration. Thanks to this test, we selected the best biocide in terms of dosage, compatibility with the storage, compatibility with the environment, and cost to treat the water from this cavern. The last example is about inspection. So in this case, we had a buried casing and we wanted to know the state of one casing of about 40 years old. So we performed one camera to get a visual aspect of the internal surface. We also passed an ultrasonic tool to check the diameter and the thickness of this casing, a caliper to observe also to double check the diameter. And we passed also some other tools, but there was no relation with the corrosion. So with the results of these tools, we discovered that the casing had some pittings inside its surface. So this inspection helped us to localize this pitting, and it was possible to see that the pittings were localized at some threading joints, especially. And with the ultrasonic tool, it was also possible to develop some 3D modelization of the corrosion points. With the camera, we can also see directly the pitting and correspond that to each pitting. Sorry, I just come back here because I wanted also to show you that with the ultrasonic tool and the caliper, it was also possible to measure the radius and to see that the internal radius was lower than the nominal one. When we have a radius that is lower than the nominal one, most of the time it's because there is a deposit on the surface. So here it was the case, and we observed a deposit of 2 millimeters on the casing surface. So we had a casing with some pittings and some deposits. So to guarantee the integrity of this casing over time, we proposed to launch the following actions. We removed the old completion and the packer. We milled the surface to eliminate the deposit of 2 millimeters, install a new liner, and install also a new packer in order to have no pitting between liner and packer. With this new proposal and this new design, we can guarantee and maintain its integrity over time. So now I have finished for the main part, and I will conclude about this presentation. So casings are subjected to internal and external corrosion. In order to increase their lifetime, three main solutions are widely used: coatings, cathodic protection, and additives. The efficacy of this solution can be controlled by an effective corrosion monitoring, fluid analysis, cathodic protection logs, corrosion coupon, and props, and also inspection tools. Corrosion monitoring participates also to the global asset integrity management, the WIMS, for underground storage. Lastly, Geostock acquired feedbacks and knowledge of corrosion monitoring over time and can propose this service if needed. So now, thank you for your attention. We have now started a new poll which proposes you three different subjects for next webinar. So you can click, I think you have started to click on the one you would have the more interest between a description of sulfidogenic bacteria, mechanism and methods to eradicate them, or a procedure for inspection of casings with more description of each inspection tools, or presentation about mined cavern operation assistance. I will also reply to your question, if any. So now, I will just check. Do not hesitate right now if you have some question. Just go back to the chat and it will be. There was no question. I will wait a little bit. So I see in your interest that the casing inspection arrives at the first place. Maybe one question. So when do you recommend to perform casing inspection? So it depends on the type of storage. For example, for mine cavern, according to administration, we have to do it every 10 years. So I would recommend to do every 10 years. But every 10 years, we do not inspect all the casing of the mine cavern, because of course it would be too complex to do it. So every 10 years, we select the casing that are the most critical for the cavern, and we inspect it with various tools depending on the possibility. Is there any special? I just finished the first question. So, and after concerning the other type of storage, so for porous media or for leach for salt cavern, there is no frequency, but most of the time we recommend to do a zero state. It's really rare that inspection of the zero state is realized, but it's important to have a reference actually for the corrosion. So actually, if you have never done an inspection, I would recommend to do it the first right now. And most of the time after, we can wait maybe 4 years to do a second one and see the evolution, and we can calculate the corrosion speed thanks to this difference of the two inspections. After, once you have measured the first corrosion speed, you can of course wait several years before doing another one. So I look at the other question. Is there any special action needed to protect welded connection? So yeah, of course, to protect welded connection, it's really important to select the right metal for your welding. And the welding of your the metal for your welding needs to be very close to the composition of the metal that you will the metal from your casing. So right now we are working on different equations to find the right composition of the welding to be sure to not have any corrosion. Of course, if you have some brine or some corrosive fluid in your casing, we would also recommend to protect the internal part of the weld. For example, you can put a coating inside or a liner. Everything would be useful to avoid any contact of the corrosive fluid in the weld. So have you used electromagnetic wireline tools for casing evaluation? Yes, we have already done electromagnetic wireline tools in the past. And what is interesting is that we have compared the electromagnetic and the ultrasonic in the same casing. And what we observed is that the ultrasonic results were more precise. For example, with the ultrasonic, we detected some pittings that we did not see with the electromagnetic. The big issue with most of the electromagnetic tools is that they will not measure a radius and a thickness, but only a thickness. So you need to combine it with a caliper to do a proper evaluation. With an ultrasonic tool, most of the time you don't need to combine it, or you can combine it also with a caliper if you are not sure of your results, but most of the time it's okay. So yeah, well, I said 4 years period, but it was just for the beginning of the inspection. Of course, after the first corrosion speed estimation, it will not be necessary to estimate every 4 years your casing. It was just to get a first corrosion speed. If you find that the corrosion speed is very low, you can enlarge your frequency. If, on the contrary, you find some presence of H2S, I suppose that you will maybe decrease your period, but you will, of course, find some way to protect your casing. For example, with some injection of corrosion inhibitors. That would be better than to do some regular control without any inhibition action. Yeah, so I continue with two more questions maybe, but there was a question about coating that I missed. Can you rank the effectiveness of the coating that you discussed? I think it's difficult to rank them. It will depend on the environment. For example, if you're for the external part that will for a pipeline that is above ground, we will prefer painting than coating. But when the coating, when the pipeline or the casing is buried, we will prefer to do a coating than a painting. A painting will be damaged by the soil, whereas a coating will be more resistant. And compared to the galvanized or aluminium solution, this will depend also on the environment. For example, we can use aluminium or zinc solution when we have an environment more marine, in water, or in air, in air with some marine atmosphere. It's not possible to inject in the water. Yeah, but this is not a question. So I'm sorry if it in your case it's not possible to inject inhibitor for André R. Maybe you can send us more information about your subject, because it's true that when you have some H2S, you need to find something to avoid some corrosion issues. One solution that I did not talk about is to select another material than carbon steel. But I suppose that in your case, the casing is already built and that you cannot change the material. You can also place a liner inside the casing, but the issue with the liner is that it's really difficult to place the liner at the welding part. And it's especially this welding part that will be corroded because of the issue we discussed before. So yeah, for this case, I would definitely need more information to answer. Okay, so thank you for your attention. I think I will stop here. Yeah, and so I will stop my broadcast if it's okay for you. Thank you very much, and have a good day.